posting on accident.
Backed by popular demand, Dr. Robert M. Price is the Bible Geek, answering your questions about the Bible and other religious texts. Welcome to the show.
Indeed, and I'd like to welcome my friend, whom I admire, Ralph Ellis. I'm mighty pleased you could be with us, Ralph.
Yeah, good to be back with you again, Robert. Yeah, nice to see you again. How's things over in across the pond, as we say, the other side?
Well, sort of, I think sometimes a death watch, all the stuff we're hearing about Putin wanting to nuke us and the EMP danger back to the Stone Age. I don't know what the heck's happening. I guess I'll just keep having what fun I can until the shadow of the bomb erupts.
Yeah, we're going back to the 1960s, aren't we? You remember duck and cover? Do they do that anymore in America, duck and cover?
I don't think so, but they'll probably start again pretty soon.
They'll start again. But for millennials who don't know what we're talking about, it was a campaign as to how you can shelter from a nuclear weapon as if you can shelter from and you're supposed to get underneath your desk at school.
Yeah, that
as if that is going to save you. But never mind.
Yeah, in 1962, I guess, in the Cuban Missile Crisis, we lived in Mississippi, and we had no basements or anything in our houses there. And my parents got kind of worried, and they took my brother and myself down under the house to see if there was any likely place we could take refuge. And they said, well, our best bed is probably under the front steps. And I knew enough to say, no, that's not going to do any good. It's not enclosed. You know, we would turn into mutants anyway. I'm hoping something will, you know, clear up the fog of war this time. But who knows?
Well, yes. Luckily, the Russians were sensible enough not to want to do it. The old song by Sting, you know, "I hope the Russians love their children too," was the old song. I forget which song that was. Someone will know in the chat. But the trouble is, what I fear nowadays, you know, getting back onto religion, I suppose, is that if we're facing Iran and the Shia, then they don't love their children, because the Iranians, a lot of the Iranians are eschatologists. And so they're looking for Armageddon. They want Armageddon. Yeah. Armageddon is the only way that they can get the 12th Imam back out of his well. He's the Mahdi. Not the mad Mahdi, he was in Africa, but this is the original Mahdi, who was the 12th Imam after Muhammad. And he went and hid down a well because he was being persecuted or something. Anyway, he went down a well. This is more than 1,000 years ago. And he is still down that well. And they're waiting for him to come out of the well. You know, 1,000 years later, they're still waiting for him to come out of the well. And I don't know if you remember the old president Ahmadinejad jacket from a few years back in Iran. He used to go to the well, you know, once every couple of months to see if the Mahdi was coming out or not. But apparently,
I heard that. I mean, I knew he was in concealment in an undisclosed location. I somehow never heard of the well business.
Oh, right.
So now I know.
It's supposed to be a famous well, but he can only come out after a nuclear war. Okay, when it was written, it wasn't written as a nuclear war. It was written as, you know, Armageddon, huge destruction, and the clouds rolling with thunder and things of this nature, which now in modern terms, of course, they interpret as being a nuclear war. And of course, the destruction of Israel. So Israel has to be destroyed before the Mahdi can come out of the well. So the trouble is with that philosophy is that as soon as Iran gets a nuclear weapon, they will use it because they want to be destroyed. They want Israel to be destroyed. They want a counterattack onto Iran to destroy most of Iran, because only then will the Mahdi come out of the well. Now, you cannot run mad at mutually assured destruction, you know, the philosophy of mutually assured destruction. You cannot run that system with the Iranians because they want to die. And so that's a real problem. And this is why I've been so against Obama giving them money, which he did, You remember just before he left office, he gave them something like 400 million. No, it was more than that. He gave them about 100 billion or something. And he gave them about 5 billion or 10 billion in cash.
I remember that,
In paper notes, which is the most absurd thing I've ever, because it's obviously untraceable. You don't know what they're going to do with it. But they couldn't even give it in US dollar bills, because apparently that's illegal. There's some law against it. I don't know what. So what they did is they flew the aircraft to Switzerland, and they picked up euros and Swiss francs. By the billion, not just the million, but by the billion, and transferred those to Iran and gave them, you know, as cash in hand. You know, here's 5 billion cash in hand in, you know, several large transport aircraft. And you think, what planet are these on? When you know that the Iranians are eschatologists and they want a nuclear war. And the idea was, if we give you all this money, you won't do any nuclear research for 10 years. Oh, well, that's going to stop them, isn't it? Oh, and we're going to pull out any of the inspectors as well. So, yeah, you're on your own. But we've got your promise that you won't do any nuclear research for 10 years. Yeah, okay. And then when Biden comes into office, the first, because of course Trump, you know, stopped all of this. He put a halt to it and put sanctions onto Iran for this very reason, because he can see the dangers of Iran. And then as soon as Biden comes in, he gives them more money. He gave them something, I forget what the figures were. It's something like 5 billion again, as a, you know, as a cash, as it were, handout. And then took off the oil sanctions, so they got another 50 billion from selling oil to Iran, who has pledged and promised to nuke Israel as soon as they get a nuclear weapon.
It's almost as if Biden and Obama also had an eschatological death wish. You know, let's see, well, maybe we can help these nuts out and then all perish together.
Yeah, they could do it in advance, you know, while we're watching, you know. So we don't know how it's done, so they should show us, you know. They should do it so we can see how it's done. I just can't believe the stupidity, because it can't be stupidity. It must be by design. And so you've got to wonder what the design is. Is that just straight evil that they want to do it, that they want to start a third world war? Because you can be sure, of course, that if Israel gets nuked, then everybody else is going to join in. You know, America is bound to join in. The local Muslim nations around are bound to join in. You know, they'll gleefully attack, you know, a wounded Israel. Russia will join in, like they did during the Six-Day War and the Yom Kippur War. It's as if they want a conflagration, you know, a World War III. You know, they are the most dangerous people on the planet for some reason, and nobody is calling them out on that. And I find that very strange, that this has been shuffled off. We don't talk about that anymore. Iran is sort of our friends. I know that they're arming the Houthi, and the Houthi are bombing American ships. But, you know, they're still our friends, you know. They're all nice people, really.
Oh, sheesh. Incredible.
I thought I'd get the show off to a good start, you see.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's one of our big topics, Armageddon and eschatology and so
yes. Yeah.
Well, we do have a bunch of questions. The first one, I think you would be great to answer. My pal, Catherine McCall, says, has there been any archaeological work done in the time frame of the Jewish revolt? Re-evidence for a historical Jesus? I guess, does it such research shed any light?
Well, no, this is the problem. It's been such an effective ploy, in my estimation, to move the date back. You know, for people who don't know, I say the Jesus character was involved in the Jewish revolt, not in the AD 20s. And it was done deliberately. It was moved back there by the Romans, who didn't want you to know that this guy was involved in the Jewish revolt. And it's been such an effective ploy that nobody has ever bothered to look for the biblical Jesus in the AD 60s, even though there is fairly good evidence that he probably did exist then. And it's the turning of the Nelsonian blind eye. I don't know if Americans get that one. This comes from Admiral Nelson, a very famous admiral in Britain. And he was given an order, but he was blind in one eye. So he put the telescope up to the wrong eye and said, I can't see any orders. so it's called turning a blind eye after Nelson. But I think everybody is doing that because, you know, Christians in general, Catholics in particular, don't want their hero character to be an AD 60s character involved in the Jewish revolt, because that's not the character that they've sold to their flocks. You know, they've got this pauper prince of peace, and that's all you're allowed to know. If this guy suddenly becomes a leader of the Jewish revolt, it changes the story somewhat. Actually, it doesn't change the story at all. The story is exactly the same, but of course the wealth and influence of the people concerned becomes much greater. And that changes the story, of course. He's no longer a pauper prince of peace. He becomes a warrior monarch, which is how I've portrayed him. And yes, so I don't think anybody else has ever looked to see if they can find him. I've been playing with this AI business recently, and I've come out with a few interesting images. This is one of them. So if I do a quick screen share, I find this quite remarkable, this new AI business. And it makes pictures for you. And this, I said, can you make... You can't call him Jesus because it'll refuse to do it. And you certainly can't say, draw me a picture of Muhammad. It'll just have a fit and say, it'll say, I'm going to delete you from the site if you dare ask for that. But it gets very, very twitchy if you ask for like Jesus on a cross or something. It certainly doesn't like that. Anyway, so what I came up with, I said, can you draw a Jesus character who's in charge of his army? And came up with this.
Wow. Looks a bit like Thor from the movies.
Yeah. I think it's heavily influenced by Lord of the Rings and things of that nature.
Yeah.
I thought it was fairly dramatic. I thought it was a nice
image. Ooh, I like it. Image. I once had an idea for a novel in which Jesus comes back and he is the head of a Christian identity sort of militia, and that he's really gunning for Armageddon as a warrior king, but I never wound up doing it.
Well, yeah, the other one I asked for was can you draw Jesus as a victorious fantasy monarch? And so it drew this, and I thought this was fairly good as well. So that's coming up now. Bing.
Whoa. Wow. You got to use that for a book cover.
Yeah, it does look like a very good jacket cover. I just love the detail it's got on the armor. I mean, it's just embossed and engraved all over the place. I mean, if you ask an artist to do that, they would spend months, you know, drawing that armor on your character. And dear old AI took 10 seconds to draw that.
Sheesh. Yeah, well, I feel totally superfluous already. I mean, I don't need me anymore if we've got AI. Sheesh. I know, by the way, that Catherine McCall, Dr. McCall, is an adherent of the idea that, yeah, Jesus has been retrojected into earlier history because he was exactly as you said. And I don't believe she has yet to read your version of it, so she's in for a treat.
Oh, yes, yes. No, I've not read anything she's written either, so that's all new to me. I'm not very up to date with what other people are writing because I'm so busy doing my own things that it's very difficult to keep up with other people's research. Mm. You know, like I hadn't even, until about 6 months ago or so, I'd never read Ehrman or people like that, you know. Mm. So I was totally unaware of his work. So I did a critique on one of his books about 6 months ago.
Oh, I'd like to read it.
Well, yes, it wasn't a very long one. It was just a bit of a critique. I wasn't that impressed because he seemed to still be hanging on to his Christian beliefs. So his research was, as far as I could see, from a Christian perspective. So he was expecting to find a pauper prince of peace. Mm-hmm. And so his whole ethos, as he was going through this book, was looking for the pauper prince of peace. Well, to me, that's not good research. You know, you've got to broaden your perspective a little bit more than that and start looking for any historical character that might suit, you know, the Jesus character, which is what I've done. Mm-hmm. You know, if you've limited yourself just to this one narrow aspect of a pauper prince of peace, you're never going to find the guy because that's what they've crafted, because that's, they didn't want you to know he was a warrior, as in the images we've just looked at. But of course, you know, if you're writing history, what do you write history about? You write history about powerful and influential people. You very rarely do we write about pauper prince of pieces. You know, it's all leaders and commanders and monarchs and people of that nature, bishops. You know, it's the important influential people in life that end up in the chronicles. And that's why I started looking for what I... I didn't start looking for a warrior monarch. I was just looking for anyone who might fit the bill of being the Jesus character. Because I found it very odd and very unlikely that such a character could go missing from history. To think that this was all completely fictional, but historical fictional, because obviously all of the characters surrounding the gospel story are historical, and yet someone has woven this story around history with this fictional character in the middle of it. I found that to be a little bit unlikely, so I was looking for who this fictional character might be. And of course, if you start looking in the AD 60s, many candidates start popping out of the mix. You know, when as soon as you start coming across people like Jesus of Gamala and so on, then you know, you realize there are possibilities out there that could match the biblical story very closely.
Mm-hmm. That I think is one of the most striking aspects of your work, that even like mythicists with whom I'm associated have always said, wait a minute, this guy was so spectacular and no historian discussed him. And you're saying, well, maybe they did, and you're not looking in enough places. I'd love to hear more discussion of that that difference in approach.
Unfortunately, mythicists have crafted their own gospel, as it were, the gospel of mythicism. And so it's difficult for them to come across and find something else. But, you know, when you find out that Jesus of Gamala Sophias, because I think Gamala and Sophias, the two Jesus characters, are the one and the same, because they appear in different sections of Josephus's books. They never appear together, sort of thing. So when you find out that Jesus of Gamala Sophias was the leader of 600 rebel fishermen, it starts to sort of, you know, come back to the gospel story again. And then when you find out that Jesus of Gamala was fighting against Josephus, and years before, I had already said that Josephus was Saul. So effectively, Jesus of Gamala was fighting a battle in Galilee against Saul. That sounds rather like Acts of the Apostles. Saul, why are you persecuting me? And then when you read Eisenman and you find out that Mary Bothus was Mary Magdalene, and then you read the Talmud and find that Jesus of Gamala married Mary Bothus.
Wow, man.
Who was Mary Magdalene, according to Professor Eisenman. You suddenly find lots of links.
I'm only dipped into this. I really need to do a lot more reading in this, because there's obviously a lot to learn.
Yeah, it suddenly becomes, yes, quite a large subject. So you're cramming the whole of the gospel story into the AD 60s. And so all of those events start showing up in that, you know, brief 10, maybe 20 years, if you include the epistles as well. In that brief period, all of the events start popping out of, you know, the woodwork. And they match very nicely. There's no forced fitting of these facts. They just slot together very, very nicely, which is always a good test of a new line of research, of a new theory.
Especially in Josephus, the story of Jesus ben Ananias. Theodore Wheaton says, look, there's over 20 points of correspondence between that account and the passion narratives of the Gospels, and to the point where I don't think it's viewed as some kind of wacky theory to say, yeah, this was the basis of the Gospel passion narrative. And of course, this man was a good bit later at the time of the fall of Jerusalem. So, I mean, it is mind-blowing.
The guy who was lamenting for the fate of Jesus and wouldn't stop lamenting for the fate of Jesus, you know. Of Jerusalem.
Yeah.
Lamenting the fate of Jerusalem. There are so many very close connections, including the crucifixion of the leaders of the revolt. Of course, the leaders of the revolt got themselves crucified, and that story is very much the same as the crucifixion story. So this was Josephus when he was a Roman commander, and he brought a detachment of troops back from Tekoa, Tekoa is Herodium, just south of Jerusalem. And he saw the three leaders of the Jewish revolt being crucified. And of course, one of the leaders of the Jewish revolt was Jesus of Gamala, because he is named as being one of the leaders of the revolt. So let's say that one of those guys being crucified was Jesus of Gamala. Well, he saw them being crucified, so he went to the governor and asked for them to be taken down early. So they were taken down early, they were given medical attention, and two of them died, and one of them survived. Very, very similar story. And then, of course, you find out that Josephus is called Josephus Bar Matthias.
Holy mackerel, yeah.
Joseph Arimathias, yes. Again, it fits the story very well, because we have the trouble with the crucifixion story where this guy pops out of history and you've got no idea who he is. He just sort of strolls onto the stage and everybody is supposed to know exactly who this guy is. And of course, we don't. So who is Joseph of Arimathea? Nobody knows. But of course, if he was Josephus Flavius, Josephus Bar Matthias, then of course everyone would have known who he was. And of course they would want to keep quiet about it, because nobody would want Josephus Flavius taking Jesus down from the cross. Because it's impossible, because it happened in AD 70. You know, it's 40 years adrift. You can't say things like that. So you've got to keep quiet about it. There's no way you can say this openly. And that's how secrets are held, because nobody wants to talk about it.
But as Jesus says in the Gospels, nothing is hidden unless it's intended to be revealed eventually.
Eventually, yes. Yes, it's a bit like COVID, isn't it? You know, nobody would talk about it, you know, where the virus came from and things of that nature, because people would lose their jobs because of it. You know, there was a penalty for talking about it. You would be demonetized. You'd be kicked off YouTube. You'd be kicked off Facebook. And so people didn't talk about it because it was difficult to talk about it. And that's exactly what they've been doing with Christianity for the last 2,000 years. It's difficult to talk about it, especially if you're within Christianity, if you're a proper Christian, but also if you're outside Christianity. You know, you can imagine during the Middle Ages all the way up until the Victorian era, when it was heretical to say such things, you could get yourself burnt at the stake. It's a good incentive not to go talking about it, to challenge the authority. Jesus was crucified in AD 30. I'll go along with that. I don't want to be burnt at the stake.
Like, for instance, if one were to suggest that St. Augustine really thought that original sin originated in a Chinese virology research center,
that sort of thing, yeah.
This is a perennial piece of curiosity. Aaron Zach asks, did Jesus have long hair as popularly depicted in paintings? Even AI seems to think so. Do we know enough about men's hairstyles at the time to... Because I've heard people say, no, it wouldn't have been long. But I don't really know what the evidence is for how long men's hair got. Have you run across?
Well, he was a Nazarene. I was just going to bring up that image again, but it doesn't seem to want to do it. I don't know why. He was a Nazarene. And the Nazarene... Oh, there he goes. Yeah. This is AI's interpretation, with long hair. And I was going to show a coin as well. I'll quickly do that as well. He was a Nazarene, and I am pretty sure, I don't know how you I don't know how you view this, but I'm pretty sure the Nazarene came from the Nazarites, from the Old Testament. And of course, the Nazarites were not allowed to poll their hair. They could not cut their hair. And so they would have ended up with long hair. And so the Nazarene, as far as I'm concerned, would have ended up with long hair. And there's good evidence for this. If you look at the, because I link, of course, these people up with the Edessan monarchy. I say that Jesus of Gamala was King Jesus of Edessa. It's the same person with the same name, just a different pronunciation. Now, the Edessans all wore long hair and beards. And we have that, if I do a present again with a coin, you can't see his long hair here, but you can certainly see the beard. This is a later King Abgarus. This guy is from the early 3rd century. But all of their coins are very much the same. They don't change.
Is the from the back of his head, is that some sort of train from the crown, or could that be intended as his hair?
That's a diadema. So they always wore a diadema headband. Wow. And so you can see that if I no, I don't want that. I've got another picture here I can jump into. Yeah, that one. So if I stop sharing that and go into the Palmyra Triad. So this is the same guy as far as I know. This is the Palmyra Triad coming up in just 1 minute. Sharing that. Now, I think this is an Edessan king. This is the famous Palmyra Triad. And so we've got Aglibol on the left. Aglibol is the moon god. You can see the moon behind his head. The guy in the center is the king. That's Belshemmen. And on the right is the sun, who's Malakbel. So that's the Palmyra Triad. Now, you can see the king has long hair and a beard. And you can see the two tassels from his diadema headband. So they wore a headband.
Yes.
Right. Like people used to do in the like the 1980s, you know, people, it was very popular for people to wear headbands. Because these headbands were made of silk, you know, so they're very, very similar to the 1980s headbands that sportsmen used to wear and so on. With two tassels hanging down the back. Now, this was a Parthian, Persian habit. You know, all of the kings of Parthia wore a, and it was a Greek, of course. It started in Greek. They always wore the diadema as well, I think. But the interesting thing about this triad, well, two interesting things. First of all, you can see the sun and the moon are androgynous. We're talking about... In today's society, we're talking about trans. Well, they made the sun and the moon trans because they had a problem with the gender of the sun and the moon, because the moon in Roman and Greek mythology was always female, but in Persia, it was male. So Palmyra sat on the borders between the two. So in order to overcome that problem, they made the sun and the moon totally androgynous. So you can't see if they're male or female. Hence the bob haircut and the sort of beardless sort of, you know, androgynous faces on them and so on. Nothing new, this trans business. So anyway, the sun and the moon were trans for the Palmyrans. But this guy in the center is the king. He's Malakbel. And this is late 1st century, this sculpture. So this guy in this triad is the biblical Jesus.
Whoa.
And that's a contemporary carving made at the time. This is first century.
Wow.
So because Edessa controlled Palmyra, it was one of their satellite cities. So this guy, and he's dressed as a king, he's got the diadema headband on the top. The diadema headband means he's a king. Now, there weren't very many kings in the late first century. You know, there was King Abgarus the Fifth, Manu the Sixth, Manu the Fifth, Esus Manu the Fifth, Esus Manu the Sixth. And then I think there was another Abgarus after the Jewish revolt, because they lost their king after the Jewish revolt, obviously, because he'd been captured. And so they had to get a new king. So there's not many kings that this guy could be. And one of those kings would have been my biblical Jesus, King Esus Manu the Sixth. So that's interesting. But you can see he's bearded with long hair, because they were Nazarene. They had converted to Nazarene Judaism in the AD 50s. Part of the Council of Jerusalem, that's what it was all about, was the conversion of these people to Judaism. And we've discussed this before, but, you know, we get the two or three accounts of this. We get the Council of Jerusalem about converting the people of Antioch. And then we get Josephus's version, which was converting the people of Adiabene to Judaism. But of course, the people of Adiabene were the people of Edessa, because the queen of Adiabene was the queen of Edessa. So it's all part and parcel of the one story of converting this monarchy into Nazarene Judaism, which occurred in the AD 50s. We have that from the Talmud. So yes, they were Jewish. And so that, and then we had, because they were Nazarene, they would not have cut their hair. That's why they have long hair and beards. And then we get the comment from Josephus Flavius, which again, I disagree with classical history. And people get very upset when I do this, but...
it's good for them.
Yeah, they love getting upset, and they don't look at the logic of what I'm trying to say. Josephus Flavius calls these people barbarians, the Babylonian Jews from beyond the Euphrates. And remember, Edessa is beyond the Euphrates. He called them barbarians, and obviously in a derogatory fashion. And of course, if you look at that up classically, and, you know, speaking with people like Richard Carrier and so on, who got very upset by this, barbarian is supposed to be someone with a different language. Bar, 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 can't speak your language, you're a barbarian. I don't believe that's what Josephus was talking about, because the people beyond the Euphrates, these Babylonian Jews, spoke Aramaic. Exactly the same as Josephus Flavius. They spoke Hebrew. It was actually more Aramaic over there, but they spoke the same language. Josephus Flavius says so. So what's the difference? Well, the difference is they were bearded, of course, because they weren't allowed to. And as you know, in Latin, it's barba.
Yeah.
Barba is your long beard. So when he's saying you are barbarian, I think that... he's talking about these people being long-haired and bearded, because Josephus Flavius was not. Neither was Saul. Saul said, you know, long hair is
shame for a man.
Yeah. So both Saul and Josephus were clean-shaven in the Roman fashion, whereas the Edessans were not. They were long-haired, and we know that. And that's why he was calling them barbarians. But that does mean that the standard depiction we have of Jesus is correct. It was long hair and beard. The only thing that I do, just to be contentious, but I think it's correct, is I give him ginger hair. So I was just, as a reminder, going to put that up. I give the guy ginger hair because there's good evidence that this was part of the ginger monarchy.
Catherine, by the way, mentioned that when she was a little girl, they all understood and saw pictures of Cleopatra with ginger hair. She never thought Cleopatra looked like Elizabeth Taylor. So it's interesting that some people seem to know and some don't. I'm going to point this out. It just suddenly occurred to me. It's kind of like the Barbaroi thing. In terms of like Jesus as a Nazarene, the connection with Nazarites, some people would say, oh, that's just a pun. But I'm not so sure, because remember, there's this hoopla over in Matthew's nativity story. Joseph is told by the angel, okay, the coast is clear, you can leave Egypt and go back home, he says great, and then he suddenly hears on the radio that Archelaus has replaced his father, and he's a worse tyrant than Herod was, and he says, I'm not sure it's safe to go. And he says, well, okay, why don't you go up north, they'll never find you there, and go to Nazareth. And then it says, and this fulfilled the scripture, he shall be called a Nazarene. People say, what scripture? What is that? And some say, could he have been kind of half remembering this thing from the book of Judges when the birth announcement for Samson is made, he shall be a Nazarite from his mother's womb. That could have been a goof, but it also could mean that they understood Nazareth, Nazarene, and Nazarite to refer to the same thing somehow.
Yeah, and of course Samson had long hair again as well.
Yep.
I think they're the same, well, for the reasons we've said and the reasons you've said there as well, but they also mean the same thing as well. So they both mean to separate off.
Mm-hmm.
And I take that to be separating off like a monk in a monastery or something of that nature. Mm. You know, the people down at Qumran on the Dead Sea. Mm. That is what I'm getting from Nazarite, Nazarene. They both mean to separate off, i.e. they don't want to be connected so much with the Jerusalem priesthood. Mm. They want to separate off and be separate and do their own thing. And I think that's exactly what they were doing. Mm. So, yeah, I think Nazarene and Nazarite, it's too close to be something new for the first century. I mean, everything in the Gospels is based in the Old Testament, of course. They were sprang out of Judaism. So where did they get this new sect from? Well, they got it from Judaism, plus they got, you know, influences from Egypt as well, of course, because I call it Egypto-Judaism, because they had lots of influences from Egypt. Hence the zodiac and so on. Mm. And while we're talking about Cleopatra, I was just going to bring up, there you go. Ooh. That's the BBC version of how they, you can bet your bottom dollar that the BBC would end up with a black Cleopatra.
Yeah.
And that was the Netflix version.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. But when we come back to reality, this is the Herculaneum version.
Yeah, so they're a lot closer to the facts.
Yeah, with ginger hair, of course. Mm-hmm. Herculaneum was buried in AD 76, wasn't it? 76 or 78. Anyway, it's... And Cleopatra would have died in 30 BC. So we're talking within 100 years of the death of Cleopatra. They were drawing these frescoes on the walls in Herculaneum. Mm. And there's a couple of these images in Herculaneum of Cleopatra. So I think we can be fairly sure that there was a strong strand of ginger within this monarchy.
Well, here's another one about archaeology. What is the most significant archaeological find, or what are the most significant archaeological finds for Judaism, Christianity, or both? And what is the most significant lack of evidence where you would have expected it?
Well, there's so many lacks. That's the problem. That's the whole reason I started this research. You know, there is no Jerusalem for the United Monarchy. It didn't exist. And I was just reading an article on Academia just today about that, highlighting the work of Finkelstein and Silberman. Jerusalem at that time, we're talking 10th century BC, was no more than a village. So where was this powerful, rich, wealthy United Monarchy? You know, the most influential monarchy in that region at the time. It simply doesn't exist. And that's always been the problem. And it's been a problem for Judaism, of course, because it means that their history is potentially based on fiction, which is why they've been shuffling this under the carpet a little bit, because it's troublesome. And but, you know, I've written to Finkelstein and I've said, look, you know, the United Monarchy does exist, but it's not in Zion, it's in Zoan.
Fascinating, yeah.
Zoran is dense. Yeah. He said, well, just because all of the names of these monarchs are the same doesn't mean that they are the same monarchy. Which was, I think, a way of getting out of it. The problem is it's politically sensitive. If I prove that the United Monarchy lived in Egypt, it means that the original homeland of Israel is actually Egypt, not Israel. They ended up in Israel because, well, the United Monarchy, you know, if it was Egyptian, if it was the 21st and 22nd dynasties of Egypt, they ended up conquering all of Judea and Israel anyway. So it was a part of their kingdom in the end. It just wasn't the capital city. The capital city was at Tanis. It was at Zoan. So those are the big lacunas, you might say, the big lack of evidence, as the question was saying, that we have. And we have, this is the whole problem with the Old and New Testaments. There's lack of evidence everywhere, you know. Where did Saul go to? Most influential person of the last 2,000 years, the guy who wrote most of the New Testament, and he disappears from history as well. Nobody knows where he is, and yet we know everybody else. I was just writing about that today because I was just starting to post on X or Twitter about this. So I've got a handle on there. It's Ralph Ellis, spelt with an F, Ralph Ellis. And I've been putting up some posts there. And, of course, everyone else we sort of know of. We know about Nero. We know about Pontius Pilate. We know about the governors of Judea and Syria. We know all about those people. They're all in the historical record. We even know some of the high priests, Ananias, you know. We've got evidence for them. But then you come to Saul, who's the, you know, most influential guy in the last 2,000 years, and we've got no evidence for him. He drops off the record. Time and time and time again, they do this all the time. And it is deliberate. It has to be deliberate because, again, they don't want to, they don't want you know to know who Saul was. And so the easiest way is just to sort of deliberately miss him from the historical record. And so, yeah, that's the game I've been playing for the last 30, 40 years, playing around with these histories, trying to find all of these people who have gone missing from the historical record.
It's funny how when there's a vacuum of evidence, agnosticism magically turns into fideism. Like we don't really have any information about Paul's death. So we say, he was beheaded by Nero. Where'd you get that? Well, from the fanciful acts of Paul, where his head is chopped off, they drag his corpse out of the throne room, and then he comes back in with his head on, milk having sprouted from the trachea, I guess, and then he says to Nero, "You're next, buddy," and then he leaves, and a few days later, his disciples go to his tomb and find it empty, and what about this? Is this true, too? It's like, we got to go with what we have. No, we don't. If what we have is obviously legendary.
And no record of his birth either. You know, so it's he's a complete mystery once again. Mm. I don't want to go through it all again now, but I say that this guy was Josephus Flavius once more. This guy had several appellations because he had to. Nobody would want Josephus Flavius associated with a gospel story. So you've got to give this guy a different name. But it just so happens the life of Saul is the same as, you know, the life of Josephus Flavius. They are one and the same. And more than that, it becomes explanatory, which again is always the, you know, good test of a theory. It's not just a theory hanging in the middle of nowhere. It's a theory with reason, and it explains things. So it explains things like, how was Saul arresting people around Galilee, the proto-Christians, the Church of Jesus and James, and throwing them into prison? More than that, he was actually murdering them as well. He was killing them. So we've got this pauper tent maker somehow arresting the Church of Jesus and James and throwing them into prison. How did that happen? Well, the guy who was doing this was Josephus Flavius. It was his job. He was the army commander in command of Galilee, and he was instructed to go around and arrest Jesus of Gamala and throw him into prison, which is what he was doing. Again, it's exactly the same. We get these very, very close connections all the time when we start looking into the AD 60s, which you cannot get if you look in the AD 20s. It's just not possible. Which is why people can't find this history. But it does mean you have to be dispassionate. You don't have to be involved in this story. You don't have to have your life affected by this story because you'll never see it. It's too difficult. If it's going to affect your life and beliefs, you're not going to want to entertain it. So you've got to be fairly dispassionate and say, well, yeah, it could be the AD 60s. It doesn't change the story much, you know. The story remains the same. It's just that the people involved are rather more influential than they are given in Acts of the Apostles. But then they have to be. You can't have tent makers who are arresting people and putting them into prison. But you can have people like Josephus doing it because he was the army commander in command of Galilee. And his job was to put people into prison. That was his job. So it makes more sense. So, that's why I think it's a true reevaluation of biblical history.
Well, with the authority for Saul, as in the book of Acts, the high priest gave him authority. How would the high priest be able to legitimate such actions, like search and destroy operations?
Well, they did in after AD 66, they did, because that's the authority for Josephus Flavius came from the high priest.
I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah, there was a power vacuum because in AD 66, of course, they defeated the legion of Cestius. A whole Roman legion was wiped out by the rebels.
Wow.
Who were the princes of Adiabene, of course, Monobazus and Kennedius, who led the army that wiped out the entire legion of Cestius. After that, the Romans withdrew from Judea. There were no Romans, and so there was a power vacuum. And so the only authority was the priesthood. And so the priesthood appointed five new army commanders to govern different parts of Judea and Israel. And it fell to Josephus Flavius, because he was obviously very powerful, and he was given command of Galilee. So that's exactly what happened, as it says. Wow. But you wouldn't give that command to a tent maker known as Saul. But you would give it to someone like Josephus Flavius, who was the first of the 24 courses or something of the priesthood, wasn't he? I seem to remember. He was very important anyway. And he was a royal from the Hasmoneans as well in his family. So he had royal and priestly connections, Josephus Flavius. He's not just a nobody. And from my work that I've done stitching together the story, I say that he was an ambassador of Edessa as well, because that's what it says, if you know what it's talking about. So, you know, this guy was influential, and that's why he got appointed as the army commander in command of Galilee.
Wow. Something just occurred to me, and I immediately forgot it. It's called senility, I guess.
All get it when we get to this age.
Aaron Zach says, what do you think of apostolicity and apostolic succession? Is there anything to that? Or as I think, is it just a kind of after the fact, whatever the fact was, a legitimation that, oh yeah, we're saying the same thing that Jesus told the first bishops and they told us. So, you know, don't worry about it.
Yes. I think it's the first of the bishops of Rome and so on. I think the first bishop of Rome would have been Josephus Flavius, who was Saul. So on his trip to go and see Nero. So I think I suppose they don't miss him out, because Saul is there in Rome, and effectively he is the first leader of the church in Rome. And so it springs from him. And of course, Josephus Flavius did exactly the same. He was the first of the church of simple Judaism in Rome. And so he would have claimed, or other people would have claimed after him, that he was the first bishop of Rome, which he effectively was. He was there for about 3 years, and he was just under house arrest. So, you know, Rome had a tendency of doing this. You know, they tend to say that, you know, he was sent to prison or whatever, but he wasn't sent to prison. Rome liked to pamper these people. It was much better than putting them into a dark dungeon. Because they could see the benefits of being Roman. So if you had a rebel barbarian like Caractacus from Britain, when he was captured, he wasn't thrown into jail. He was given every luxury that Rome could afford. He wasn't allowed to leave, of course. He was sort of under house arrest. But whatever you wanted, you know, you could have. Whatever beauties, you know, you could find in Rome. Dining on lark's tongues and whatever, you know. all of the luxuries of Rome.
Wow.
To show Caractacus the benefits of being Roman. So eventually he could be sent back to Britannia and be a client king for Rome, a loyal client king of Rome. And that's a, they didn't always do that. I suppose it depended on the person, but they tried to do that where possible. And I think they did this with Saul Josephus. He was pro-Roman anyway, I think. But they showed him the benefits of Rome, showered him with gifts. Remember, he was a favorite of Poppaea. I say there's a little bit of an intrigue there because he was a favorite of Poppaea, and Poppaea was known for seducing young men. And of course, Saul Josephus at that time would have been a young man. And while he was there, Nero kicked Poppaea to death because she was pregnant. And then Saul Josephus skips back to Judea without saying goodbye, you know. It just struck me that he might have been involved in this little affair somewhere. And involved in the death of Poppaea. So, that was a little aside. I mean, we have no evidence of that, but, you know, it's just a nice, funny little aside.
Yeah, but he was a favorite. Pregnant with a new little apostle?
Yeah, absolutely. And Nero was not terribly impressed. But, you know, having been showered with all of these gifts and all of the luxuries of Rome, I think he became a spy at that point. Working for Rome, this would have been AD 62-ish, something of that nature, when he sailed to Rome and had the shipwreck and everything else. I put that around AD 62, something of that nature. So he was there from 62 to about 65-ish, roughly. And then when Poppaea died, he skipped immediately back to Judea, so nobody could find him. But working for Rome as a spy with Vespasian as his handler, because Rome had a problem. Rome didn't understand Judaism. It was all very peculiar to them because it was not very Roman. They knew that revolts were brewing in the East somewhere. They wanted eyes on the ground to find out what was going on. Who better than Saul Josephus to keep them informed about what was going on? So when we have this story about Saulus going to Greece to tell them what was happening in Judea, I think that was Saul. So Saulus was Saul, because he went not necessarily to see Nero, because Nero was in Greece, remember. But so was Vespasian in Greece. Remember, he fell asleep at the theater and nearly got got his head chopped off. So I think that Saul was there in Greece to go and see Vespasian and to warn him about what was going on in Judea. This would have been AD 65-ish, just before the Jewish revolt. And so I think I get this idea. I mean, we don't really have any evidence for this, but it would make sense in a strategic fashion. You know, Rome wasn't full of dummies. You know, they'd conquered an empire that was bigger than any other empire in the world. They knew how to run empires. They knew how to control client kings. They knew how to control kingdoms and keep them in peace. And part of that was having lots of spies telling you what was going on. And who better to do the spying than Saul Josephus?
Have you read a book called Operation Messiah?
No, I haven't actually, no.
You would find it interesting because it puts it a bit differently, but the two authors make the case that Paul was a Roman operative. It's very, I think you would really enjoy it.
Yeah, I must have a look at that. What's it called again?
Operation Messiah.
Operation Messiah. I must see if I can get that and have a read. Yeah,
it's a fairly new book. I'm sure it's available. Oh.
I will have a look at that, because yes, you never know when you read someone else's material like that. They pick up on different aspects of the same story.
Yeah.
And so you find out, other bits that you didn't realize were happening. But it's something that makes sense. And I think it's certainly worth exploring a little bit more, because it would certainly explain why Vespasian was expecting Josephus to surrender to him. When he surrendered during the Jewish revolt at Jotapata, during the siege of Jotapata, when he came out of the dungeon, it was this: Vespasian was saying something like, "Well, why did it take you so long?" sort of thing, as if he was expecting him. And everybody was in awe of Josephus, even though he was on the other side and being captured, it just struck me that he was already well known to Vespasian, and Vespasian was expecting him to come across to him and join the Romans.
Which he did.
Which he did.
Yeah, boy.
He certainly did.
Let's see if there's another good one that here's something interesting. Are there any records of other Jews claiming to be the Jewish Messiah during the time of Jesus? That sort of begs the question of what the time of Jesus was, but
yes. Well, there were several, weren't there? I can't remember all the different ones, but I say that Judas of Gamala, who obviously I relate to Jesus of Gamala, was doing exactly the same thing back in the AD 40s or whatever. So he was the leader of the fourth sect of Judaism, which you might well equate with Nazarene Judaism, because, we know the other three, the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Essene. So who was the fourth sect who doesn't get named? I think it's probably the Nazarene. So in which case, Judas of Gamala. The trouble with this duplication business is we don't necessarily know if these are different people or the same people in a duplication in the text. Because the text has been, it's an AD 60s story. Somebody has thrown that text back into the AD 20s. Now, is Judas of Gamala a different person, like the father of Jesus of Gamala? Or is that just the same story that's been stuffed back into the AD 20s? We don't exactly know, but we do get reports, very similar reports, of similar events with similar Messiah types or people who would have been messiahs if they'd sort of succeeded. Einhorn does a fairly good graph of this. I forget what a Christian name is.
Lena,
that's right. Lena Einhorn does a good graph of this, where she compares the AD 60s and the AD 20s.
Yeah, and fascinating.
All the similar events in those two different eras, demonstrating that there has been duplication. I think there was lots of, well, the other Messiah, of course, was John the Baptist. It's pretty obvious that he was the originator of this in the previous generation, because we get this confusion. If you look at some stories, they equate Jesus and John the Baptist. If you look at Michelangelo and his, was it Angelo? Yes, I think it was Madonna and the Rocks. Or is that Leonardo? Anyway, it was one of the two. I think it was Michelangelo. His Madonna and the Rocks, John the Baptist and Jesus are the same age. So some people were equating them as being the same time. Obviously, I don't, because John the Baptist was definitely AD 35.
That's a big trouble chronologically for the Gospels. Yeah.
Quite accurately, plus or minus 2 years, John the Baptist was beheaded in AD 35, plus or minus 2 years, something of that nature. We're fairly accurate on that because we've got the tetrarchs who were dying around him, you know, like Philip and so on, Tetrarch Philip. We've got dates for them, so we can date that fairly accurately. And then the Jesus character, of course, is the next generation. He's an AD 60s character, in my estimation. So the forerunner to Jesus in the previous generation would have been John the Baptist. So he would have been the original Messiah, which is why, of course, you get people like the Mandeans who venerate John the Baptist, not Jesus, because he was the original Messiah. But he managed to get his head chopped off. And then, you know, the Messiah's not very good if he's managed to get his head cut off. So they had to go searching around for a new Messiah. But yeah, the Templars and the Mandeans and various other people venerated John the Baptist because he was the first king of the new great month, the first of the Fisher Kings. Because the processional great month of Pisces started in AD 10. So the first of the Fisher Kings would have been someone who was born around AD, you know, turn of the first century, AD 0, AD 10. Now, in my book, or maybe you might say who was crowned, as it were, in about AD 10, that would have to be John the Baptist. In my book, Jesus would have been born either in AD 6. He could have been born in AD 6, you know, the census of Quirinus. Or he could have been born in AD 14. This is going on to the history of the Edessans, that the king of the Edessans was taken as a hostage in Rome for 7 years. And so there is a gap where he could not be born because he just was not there until AD 14, when he gets back to Edessa and obviously had another child when he got back from his stay in Rome, courtesy of Octavian Augustus, who kept him in Rome because they didn't trust these people. So he was kept there in order to ensure the fidelity of his people. And so he was under house arrest in Rome for 7 years.
What do you think of the Slavonic Josephus? Because he, as the way Eisler read him, he had John the Baptist as a figure considerably before Jesus, so the date still wouldn't match the New Testament. But that he makes it more of a Messiah. He says he's called the Man, and he thinks that has to do with the Son of Man and all that, and that he was an apocalyptic preacher and so forth. And then Jesus came later and was a rebel against Rome. What do you think of Slavonic Josephus in general?
I've not come across that in the Slavonic Josephus. I must read that. I didn't come across that. I was interested in the difference in the surrender of Josephus, because in the Slavonic version, it's very much that Josephus is laughing at his colleagues for killing themselves, which is not, because you know that there's 30 of them sitting in the dungeon and they all sort of elect to commit suicide. And the last man standing, of course, is Josephus. It's not explained why that happened in the normal Josephus, but in the Slavonic version, it's very much that Josephus is having fun at his colleagues all killing themselves.
Wow.
Yeah, no, I didn't read that other bit about Jesus. So this is a slightly different testimonium flavium then.
Yeah, there's a lot more of it, and it's the Slavonic version of the Wars of the Jews, which I've not read the whole thing. I don't have it, but I have read Robert Eisler's The Messiah, Jesus, and John the Baptist, which is really eye-opening page after page. There's a terribly neglected major book. Oh, boy.
I presume it must be an addition to the testimonium flavium, which is the only extract we have of
Yes.
Jesus within Jewish wars. But of course, that's an interpolation
Yeah.
that had to have come from someone like Eusebius.
Yeah, and that's my candidate for the job, yeah.
But they've obviously got a longer version with a slightly different testimonium. So I'll have to have a look at that. That would be interesting. See what they say. But it would be interesting, yes, if you say that he was a rebel against Rome. Because we know that he was a rebel. I mean, it says so in the Gospels. He was a rebel who was jailed alongside revolutionaries who had committed murder in the revolution. He was the drunkard. It's not said very much, especially in the pulpit. He was the drunkard who associated with sinners and tax collectors. And he was known for being a drunk, which, of course, I mean, it suits my thesis quite well. Young princes are quite often wild childs, aren't they? Often getting drunk and, throwing their authority around at a young age. One can
Especially if
imagine
their
the
name is Hunter, I think
Yes, especially if the
this sounds
Yes.
like the redeemed redeemer in the hymn of the pearl in the Acts of Thomas,
Yep,
where he
very
is
much so.
from the Pleroma to Egypt to on a mission, and he gets so enthralled with the sensuality and the booze and all that, he says, "Why did I come here again?"
Forgets the reason completely for actually being there. Yeah, I mean, it is. It's that story, isn't it? It's exactly the same. I mean, again, in modern terms, not quite as bad as Hunter, but Bush Jr. apparently. Bush Jr. He was a bit of a wayward lad, wasn't he? Until he became, and then when he became president, he had to say yes, or I've left all of that behind me, sort of thing. Because everyone was saying that he was just, a drunk, how can we have him as president? It
Oh
does
boy.
happen.
Things don't seem to change
No,
much.
they don't.
Catherine McCall again says, I saw lots of posts about the Mahdi around October 7th. Thanks, Dr. Ellis, for explaining why.
Is that because it was Ramadan? I don't know if he has a special day or not. I don't know.
Well, if it was like the Hamas thing was, they keep calling it a
Oh,
genocide attack.
that yes, that October the 7th. Yes, sorry, yes, I forgot. Yeah, of course they would be invoking the Mahdi because the Mahdi is supposed to, through his influence, kill all of the Jews. So yes,
Yeah,
they would be
boy.
celebrating the Mahdi, yeah. The Mad Mahdi from Africa was an African, a Sudanese guy, who claimed he was the Mahdi. So he said, "Yeah, I'm the Mahdi. I've resurrected myself. I'm the Mahdi." And so he became the Mad Mahdi. This is what Britain was fighting against, the Mad Mahdi. This is during the Victorian era. This is the ni late 19th century.
So they sent Charlton Heston in after him.
It was, wasn't it? Yes, I seem to remember. Yes, I forget who the British commander was. Yes, who was in charge of that
Chinese
region?
Gordon.
Yes, that's yeah. It was General Gordon who did his last stand in his fortress.
Boy, oh boy.
Yeah, good film that one. Good film. They don't make films like that anymore.
Oh. And Heston was in so many of them, like the Buccaneers, where he plays Andrew Jackson and looks amazingly like him. And he says, "I swear by the Lord God, I'll kill the next man who moves."
That's exactly how he spoke, didn't he?
Yeah, I love that guy. Or how about Moses? You know, commandment number one, thou shalt have the right to keep and bear arms.
Yeah. I love that guy. Now, that's supposed to be commandment number two, isn't it? Isn't
that the second, oh, right.
Second Amendment, yeah.
Oh, boy. Let's see. Oh, here's one you're going to be good on, too. Z. Stallone says, how influential was Egyptian myth on the origins of Christianity? Is it greater than Zoroastrian influence?
Well, because they came from both traditions, I think there's a mix of the two. So I say that these people came out of Egypt. So there's lots of influences from Egypt. I say that the Edessan monarchy was related to Cleopatra, obviously from Egypt. And so they had a lot of traditions came out of there. And remember, Jesus went to Egypt for his education. You know, he was there for nearly a decade or whatever. And he would... I've had people saying, oh, he didn't go for his education. Yeah, but he was there during his youth. When do you get educated? You get educated during your youth. And so, yeah, he was supposed to be there for his youth, which is when you go to college. And, of course, the greatest of all the universities was in Egypt. So if you're a prince of Edessa, of course, you're going to send some of your princelings to Alexandria to have the best education you could possibly have. I think that's probably correct. I mean, we're just getting that from the Gospels, but I think that's correct. One of the reasons I think it's correct is because at his marriage at Cana, Jesus was turning water into wine. And of course, well, we've looked at this before, but that jug came from Alexandria. Somewhere here we've got a little image of it. Here we go. I'll just blow that up a little bit. So if I do a quick screen share. And this is it. We've still got the original drawings for it. So this is a trick jug made by Hero of Alexandria for turning water into wine.
Oh, man.
And this was a well-known trick in this era. Hero, or Hieron, made four different types of these jugs, especially for turning water into wine. Now, this was well known. Everybody knows it. We've still got the original drawings. This is, you know, a drawing that's 2,000 years old.
Wow.
And it's got two compartments, as you can see, and you can separate the water and the wine. Mm-hmm. And if you look at K on the top, there's a K. There's a little hole in the top of the handle. And it depends whether you've got your thumb over the hole or not as to whether you get wine or whether you get water. So it's very clever, and it's quite obvious that Jesus was entertaining his people at his wedding with this trick jug. Now, these jugs came out of Alexandria. It's pretty good evidence, I think, that Jesus probably did go to Alexandria for his education. So he would have picked up a lot of this and brought it back via Persia, because they came out of Persia to end up in Edessa. And they would have ended up with all of this Egyptian stuff. So you would get the influence of the zodiacs as well, because I'm not entirely sure if standard Judaism was venerating the zodiac. But if we do a quick share, this is what they were doing. Now, this zodiac obviously is exactly the same as the Dendera zodiac in Egypt. Mm. If you go down to the Temple of Dendera, it's a standard Egypto-Greek or Greco-Egyptian zodiac. This information probably came out of Egypt because I think the Persians had different signs for their zodiac, so it wouldn't have been the same. So this is more Egyptian. And this particular zodiac was owned by Jesus. Jesus of Gemala. Josephus Flavius says so, although the archaeologists on site who uncovered this would disagree. They say it's 3rd century. But Josephus Flavius gives a very good description of him being sent by the Jerusalem priesthood to destroy the heretical images of animals 4 furlongs south of Tiberias. And if you go 4 furlongs south of Tiberias, you come to this zodiac, which is a Jewish zodiac in a synagogue, which I think is 1st century, because the head of Helios is pointing at the conjunction between Aries and Pisces, which in processional terms is AD 10. So the head of Helios is pointing at AD 10. I think this is 1st century, and it was owned by Jesus of Gemala Sophias, the leader of 600 rebel fishermen. And I think, you know, this is the biblical Jesus again. So, and these traditions, I'm sure, came out of Egypt. So there would have been lots of Egyptian influences. And remember, the Talmud says that Jesus came out of Egypt with the secret name of God tattooed on his thigh. Again, you know, it's indicating education at a very, very high university in Egypt and the secrets of Egyptian religion coming out of Egypt into Judea with Jesus. The only thing that the Talmud doesn't say is it doesn't say what that name of God was. It would have been much more interesting if they had told us which name it was. But if it came out of Egypt, I think it would probably be the Arden, because the Jewish God was known as the Arden. If you're looking at translation of the Old Testament, it's normally where it says Lord God in the Old Testament. That's Adonai. And of course, the Arden is the god of Pharaoh Akhenaten. So I think that's probably what he was bringing out of Egypt, was the name, that name of God.
Well, there's an interesting theory that I just made up, that Jesus didn't do that well in Egypt. He couldn't finish high school, but he managed to get to come back home with a GED degree. But he was so poor a speller that he thought it said G-O-D, and that that was him. And that's where we get the idea of the divinity of Jesus. just kidding.
Yes. Yes, you never know how well he was educated when he was there. Princes had the best of educations, but not all princes are very bright. You've only got to see our King Charles to know that.
Oh boy.
Yeah, he wasn't the brightest. He wasn't the, what do they say? He wasn't the brightest bulb in the box. Yeah.
Or in England, the brightest candle in the wind. Let's see here. There's a bunch of these things. Peter Rabbit says, Ralph, can you speak on two events? Jesus at age 12, supposedly lost to Mary and Joseph, and the naked boy at Jesus' arrest.
Yes, I can do that. The first one is his bar mitzvah. So he's caught, you know, he gets lost, and they're searching around for him, and they find him eventually in the temple, instructing the high priests, you know, as you do when you're 12, you know. Because he was such a precocious little child, you see. He was instructing the high priests. Well, Josephus Flavius does exactly the same. So he narrates exactly the same story. When he was 14, he was found in the temple instructing the high priests because he was such a precocious little boy. So, yeah, okay, so now we've got the same story twice. And it's pretty obvious that this is a bar mitzvah. Because at the bar mitzvah, one of the things you must do is you must prove that you are a good Jew. And therefore, you must give readings from the Torah, and you must be questioned on various aspects of the Torah by the rabbi. Otherwise, you don't pass your bar mitzvah. Well, if you're a prince, if you're someone important, it wouldn't be the local rabbi. It may well be the high priest who is now going to ask you a few questions to make sure you understand what Judaism is all about, and you can pass your bar mitzvah. And that is what they were doing. So it's not a miracle at all. It was just these very precocious, very important young princes who were going for a bar mitzvah at the temple, no less, being questioned by the high priest. And both Josephus and Jesus did exactly the same. And then we get the young boy. So this we're jumping ahead now. So this is much later. And again, we have two accounts. I always like it when you get two or three accounts that point at the same story. And again, we get two accounts of this. So they have this night meeting on the Mount of Olives, which is interrupted by the Roman guard. And at that time, so the Roman guard comes up to capture Jesus, and this young boy who only had a robe around him escapes naked. What's that all about? Well, we get the same story from Josephus Flavius. Again, the two stories match. But Josephus Flavius says it was the Egyptian false prophet. And he had the meeting on the Mount of Olives with 30,000 armed men. But it was interrupted by the Roman guard, and all of the people were scattered and they all ran away. It's obviously the same story, because the Egyptian false prophet is Jesus. We've got a fairly good idea that that's correct, because the Egyptian false prophet was the guy who took the 5,000 out into the wilderness. Now, who took the 5,000 out into the wilderness? That was the Jesus. So they're both doing the same thing. The Egyptian false prophet and Jesus both go into the wilderness with 5,000, and they both have this night meeting on the Mount of Olives, which is interrupted by the Roman guard. It is the same story. The only difference in the gospel one is we have this young naked boy who runs off naked because this meeting is interrupted. What's that about? Well, that is the ceremony for making a gali priest. And the galley priests were eunuchs, of course. They had to be castrated. So this was a castration ceremony. This is exactly what Jesus was saying in Matthew 19:15, is it? I'm forgetting my verses.
Yeah, I think 19 is correct. I couldn't tell you the
1912. I was close. Matthew 19:12. For there are some eunuchs who were born from their mother's wombs. There are some eunuchs who were made eunuchs by men. But there are some eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven's sake. Mm. He that is able to receive it, let him receive it. Quite obviously to me, this young lad was receiving castration. And that's why he was naked. So this was a ceremony. And that was Jesus asking for his disciples to castrate themselves. This is not just nobody. this was the ceremony in order to make a Gali priest, which was a high position. You know, this was very prestigious. And this young lad was obviously being made high priest, or high priest, a priest, by castrating himself. And that's what this ceremony was all about. Another reason for the Roman guard interrupting this meeting was not only was this a potential armed assault on Jerusalem, that was the reason they were there, but also castration was illegal in Rome, so you weren't supposed to be doing this. So there was two good reasons for interrupting this ceremony. But the reason I think this was Peter, because in Arthurian legend, and okay, we're not going to go into why there are similarities here, but there are many similarities here between the gospel story and Arthurian legend. But in Arthurian legend, it is Percival. It is Percival Galahad. So he has a dual name. He is Percival the Galahad. Percival the Galley. It even has the same name. The Galley priests were the castrated priests of Attis and Cybele. And Percival Galahad has the same name.
Wow.
And the Galley were castrated. They were eunuchs. And Percival does exactly the same. He castrates himself in Arthurian legend to become the Galley, to become the Galahad.
Whoa, interesting.
It's the same story.
Huh.
And this is why I think that, you know, this naked boy is the Galley. He's the new Galley priest.
Huh.
And they were known as
Peter.
I think these, yes, because in Arthurian legend, Percival is the new, young, precocious young knight who is the next greatest knight of all the knights, but he's very young. And I think for many reasons in looking at these connections that I think the Percival character is the Peter character.
Huh.
And so, yeah, he is the rock upon which, you know, this church will be built. He is the keeper of the stone. Remember, he is the Peter is the Kephas. He is Peter. Well, his name is not Peter, of course. His name is Simon. Simon the Peter, Simon the Kephas. He is the stone. But of course, it was Percival who was the keeper of the Holy Grail stone in Arthurian legend. Because the Holy Grail was the sacred stone. And so Peter is the stone, and so was Percival, the keeper of the stone. Again, they match. There's multiple sources. It's not just saying, oh, I think one person is another person. There's multiple reasons why I think these two characters are connected. And they both castrated themselves.
Percival, that can't happen every day.
Yes, it's not something that happens every day. Percival did it because they tempted him with a woman. I love the way they do this. So they tempted him with a woman who was actually the devil, but dressed as a woman, who tried to seduce Percival. And the only way he could get out of it, being seduced by the devil, was to castrate himself.
Whoa. I guess this is the origin of Elvis's song, Devil with a Blue Dress On.
Yes. Yeah.
Boy.
Such wonderful stories we got from
all. Oh, yeah. Who could not be interested in this, absorbed by this stuff?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's so great. Well, we've been on over an hour and a half. I probably should get going.
Yeah.
And you probably have to as well. I cannot tell you how much I've enjoyed this and how honored I am to have you on the Bible Geek.
It's my pleasure, Robert. I'm really glad to be on with you. It's really great to see you again.
You too.
You got one from Constellation Pegasus right here with the, like that real quick.
Mm-hmm. I should do that. Oh, the last question.
Rashi's commentary says Leviathan was a male and female pair. God had to kill the female because the world could not exist. God had to kill the female so that the future people could exist. What is Leviathan? Well, the great dragon whose remains were the basis of the creation of the world, I think.
Well, the Nazarene had a similar sort of philosophy, I suppose, because they venerated the primeval Adam. And the primeval Adam was a hermaphrodite or androgynous. Hmm. So again, either a sexless being or a male and female combined. I'm not quite sure which.
Hmm.
I think probably an androgynous. And just from my work on the Old Testament, I have an inkling that the primeval Adam was Pharaoh Akhenaten.
Hmm.
Because he always displays himself as being naked. both of them, in fact. See if I can just pick something up very quickly.
Hmm.
Let's have a look at this one. So, if I do a quick screen share. Okay, coming up. Okay, so that is Akhenaten and Nefertiti. And as you can see, Akhenaten is naked. he has no skirt on, nothing. And he's androgynous. he has no genitalia. He's a bit female and he's a bit male. He's got the wide hips of a female. He's got the bust of a female. But he is still a male, but he has no genitalia. And then on the right, we have Nefertiti. And as you can see, she has been portrayed naked. Now, this statue would have to be commanded by the queen. Nobody would be so bold as to draw the queen naked if they had not been told to do so.
Mm.
So, as I've said on a few occasions before, they were like a sort of hippie commune down there at Amarna. And they floated around Amarna naked. And it was probably quite shocking, I think, to the Egyptians. It would be like our monarchy today, if you can imagine William and Kate at an awards ceremony in London, giving out the awards while naked. And this is what they were doing in Amarna. We've got images of Nefertiti and so on at an awards ceremony, giving out awards while naked.
Whoa.
But we know that these two were formative in the creation of Judaism. Psalms 104 is the hymn to the Aten, which was a hymn actually written by Pharaoh Akhenaten. So for many reasons, and of course the Judaic god is called the Aten, the Aten. For many reasons, these were the first monotheists, of course. This is where monotheism of Judaism came from. Akhenaten was the first of the monotheists. So for many reasons, we know...
Go ahead.
We know that. Yeah, we know this pair were involved in the formation of Judaism. And so if the Nazarene were looking back to the primeval Adam, well, perhaps they were looking back towards Akhenaten as being the androgynous original being. Because he wasn't the primeval Adam was not God as such. He was just a demiurge. Hmm. He was a creator demigod, not the high god. Hmm. So could Akhenaten be a demiurge, you know, a demigod? It's possible.
When Jesus says in Matthew 11, no one knows the Father except, no one knows the Son except the Father. No one knows the Father except the Son and any to whom the Son deigns to reveal him. I've heard that that appears to be a quotation from either that hymn by Akhenaten or another one where he says, "O Aten, no man knoweth thee save for thy Son, Akhenaten." Holy yes. Mackerel.
That's, yes. Yeah, a lot of this philosophy came out of Egypt. I've got a list of about 10 different sections within the Old and New Testaments that came out of Egyptian traditions. Mm. So, yeah, including, you know, the Sermon on the Mount and the Ten Commandments and so on. Mm. So a lot of this did come out of ancient Egyptian tradition. Mm. And wow. I think this was very formative. And, of course, these people did come out of Egypt, according to my research. Mm. So that's where they got it from.
Yeah. Mm. Oh, well, thanks again. Very enlightened.
Well, I hope everyone
soon again, I hope.
Yeah, I hope everyone enjoyed it. Yeah, I'm busy. Just as a quick promotion before we go, I'm writing a new book. So this is going to be Shards of Illumination 2. So the first Shards of Illumination was a compendium of all of my Facebook posts. Which was quite a, it's 550 pages, you know, so it ended up as quite big. So that was loads and loads of different posts on lots of different subjects, obviously mostly religious stuff, but including some bits on climate and politics and various other things. So that was interesting. But time has moved on. I've now got enough material for another book. So I've now got Shards Illumination 2.
Great.
Just when you thought it was safe to go back, you know, onto the internet. And so that one's just coming to completion. Hopefully it'll be out just later than this month. And again, it's a compendium of all of my posts on Facebook. Lots of different topics. Mm. Mostly, I suppose, Old and New Testament, but lots of different topics. Mm-hmm. And some of the things we've been talking about here as well. So some longer posts about Islam, the, you know, the golden age of Islam, the Zodiac, the Hukuk mosaic and so on. Mm-hmm. So lots of different posts. Hopefully that will be very interesting to people as well.
Oh, I'm sure it will. Yeah.
Yeah, and I hear you're busy as well doing another book or something.
I have one or two that are pretty much finished. One is called The Heresy of Paraphrase, and in it I have Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Thomas kind of rephrase the way I tend to teach these things with a few added comments here and there and a couple of jokes here and there. And so I figured, well, if I do it orally, I might as well do it on paper. So I want that one to come out pretty soon. And I'm waiting for Houses of the Holy, which is going to be a huge survey of 12 major religions and where they came from. And I've scripted a comic book called All Gnosis Comics. And that's in the works with a friend of mine from Argentina doing the art. So I got all kinds of wacky things in the works.
That sounds like a lot of hard work to me, especially, you know, the history of 12 religions. You could end up with 1,000 pages on that easily.
Well, it's at least 600, maybe more. I don't know how many words to a page in the finished thing, but it is massive. I do Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, Zoroastrianism, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, the Mandeans, the Yazidis, the Baha'is, and did I mention the Sikhs? But at any rate, yeah, it's 12 of them. I try to give decent shrift to the tiny and minority religions. Oh, and the Druze, that was the 12th one. Mm. And they're all so fascinating. Yeah. And we know a bit about them. So I decided I'm going to be subtitled How's the Holy Survey, a historical... No, sorry, a higher critical scrutiny of the world religions. And so it's going to be a lot of fun, I think. Oh, yeah, and also
I was going to say that sounds like a very useful reference book. It's sort of thing that everybody will need sitting on their shelf somewhere, you know?
Well, I think so, because a lot of these books are just introductory, which is all right, like Houston Smith. But because it's introductory, it's really much oversimplified. And I decided, let me see if I can get across in plain and entertaining speech the intricacies of these religions and how they evolved and what they think. And I think I did pretty well. So I'm really eager for it to come out. I got a 5-volume collection of H.P. Lovecraft's fiction and some of his poetry, heavily annotated with essays by myself. Actually, I did this about 30 years ago, but publishers kept letting me down. And so finally, that's going to come out. So I'm really eager for all this stuff to be born.
Excellent. Yeah, yeah. Mm. Oh, I bet you're really, really glad about that. It's nice when you can get something actually finally published after a long time. That's very good.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Excellent.
Okay, right. I'll see you again soon.
Indeed, yes. Thank you.